Ben, 100K? When? Back in the day?
Back in the day.
Okay, you're like an old school, one of the early adopters.
Yeah, it's been almost 20 years. Yeah. Michigan, yeah.
Okay, well, that's right.
Somebody in Michigan.
But you're 100K. You I was somebody in Michigan. Exactly. But which 100K? Did you come back like way back? Because we've been doing these since...
No, I haven't even...
Oh, gotcha. Well, yeah, you, yeah, well, that's a given. Yeah, that's, yeah, he's, yeah, he's in. Hey, Chris, how are you, man? Good. So, first time coming to our 100K sessions. All right, good deal. All right, and you said repeat.
Repeat.
All right, remedial summer school. All right.
Booster shot.
That's our booster shot. Okay, all right, good deal. All right. And then any non-future home agents? Everybody's future home. All right, good deal. All right, good. Because I introduced myself to the group last night and made sure and introduced myself as your broker. You guys know I'm your broker, right? Everybody knows that? Okay, good. All right, that's a good thing. All right, so we all think Jim is, and I get that, all right? But Jim, he is a broker, all right? But I'm still officially the broker of record. Jim is the guy who handles all the problems, though. So that's why I started the 100K group page, right? The Facebook group page. You guys are on that. We'll talk about that. You got to join that because that's the best. Get all your questions answered. People, really solid agents, there. And I get up in the morning and I do my broker duties. Like. That's a great answer. Well, that was solid information. Great. Like. I'm done. All right. And I've done all my duties as a broker. Now I can move on and do my other stuff. So that's how we roll. All right. So 100K. Here's a story of 100K. Ben, I thought you had come to 100K before. Been teaching these 100K sessions for... long time, right? We started back in 08 when it started because in 08 the market had tanked. We had about, I don't know, 300 agents in our system at the time, and at any given time about 180 of them were ready to jump off the Skyway Bridge because life as we know it had ended, right? There, you couldn't stick a sign in the yard and things just sold automatically for you and everything was, you know, not, you know, the panacea that was real estate just fell off the table overnight, right? And so it was done. So I said, all right, that's it. I've been waiting for the market to turn. Finally, I'm glad. Here we go. This time, this place, this date, be here. I'm going to show you how to make $100,000 a year in this business right now in this market. All right? 180 of our agents showed up. It was amazing. 300 agents total, 180 show up. We don't have those kind of percentages that show up to our Christmas party, right? It was just people were coming out of the woodwork, people I hadn't seen forever, all right? And within the first 5 minutes, I lost half of them. They were gone. Half of those 180, because I told them they were going to have to work, right? Whoa. They say, well, hang on now. You didn't mention anything about that. I saw the 100K part, all right, but I didn't see, and I thought we were going from 1099 to W-2, and you were going to sign me up and pay me a salary, and I must have misunderstood. And I said, yeah, you must have misunderstood, right? So, but here's the reality. Of that group that stuck, we decided we're going to reinvent ourselves and find a way to make this happen, all right? And we did. And all I'm going to do is, through this 100K, it's kind of evolved, Gary, because the first part of 100K I'm going to teach you is what I knew and then also what I taught early on, because that's all I knew, right? And the second half is something that I've kind of self-discovered along the way, along with some other books that I've read and some different things. And it's a better way to go about it, quite frankly, a better way than I approach my business. The first half is kind of how I approach my business. Great way, did well, but it was kind of an endless cycle, never stayed done kind of thing. And I wanted, you know, there's got to be a better way. So we're going to teach you a better way as well. All right. So there's two halves of this, and we're going to walk through both of them. And kind of this intro is going to be a little bit more me talking than you dialoguing. So hang with me. We'll go through this quickly. But the sessions are designed. Anybody been through Bold? Okay. Bold. All right. It's kind of... a couple differences between I've never been to Bold, but from what I've heard of Bold. First of all, I think we're going to teach you a little bit different aspect. We're not going to, you know, have a breakout session. Everybody go call chiropractors. Go. All right. Okay. We're not going to do any of that kind of stuff. And there's not cold calling involved. The other thing that's different, I didn't ask for an $850 check before he walked in the door. There's a big difference, right? So because of that, here's the good news. Since you don't have to pay me anything, you know, that's good news, right, to be here. The bad news is you lose your right to be offended. All right. Okay. So if I offend you, that gives me the right to, okay, I'll refund all the money you paid to get in the door, okay? Is that fair enough, all right? So that's the bad news about not having to pay, is that now you've walked in and signed away. You remember, you guys clicked that I agree, all right, when you registered?
You know, that's what,
you didn't know, you never do, exactly. It says it, you can't be offended by anything I say, and that you're not gonna take me too literally, and you're not gonna, even if it'll be on YouTube later on, that you aren't gonna, you know, I can still, deny, all right? I'm going to deny things on the front side.
If we pay you twice as much, can we offend you?
That's right, exactly. That's right. Twice zero is still zero, so there you go. All right. All right, so we're going to talk about mindset, all right? First of all, because like Bold and anything that's good training, we're going to talk about that. We've got to get ourselves in a proper mind frame, all right, before we can actually do this stuff. By the way, $100,000 a year is just a number I picked, right? Just a number. Hey, Tanya, how are you? The number that sounds good, right? It's a six-figure income. It puts you in the top 5% of not only real estate agents in the country, but the top 5% of wage earners in America, all right? So it sounds, I mean, it's a good, now that might be too low or too high for you. You put your number in, all right? And is it all about the numbers? No, we're gonna talk about a lot about the fact that it's more than just the money. However, guess what? It's an important aspect of life. Whether we wanna admit it or not, all right, it takes a currency to exchange to survive in this world, all right, okay? And for right now, in the United States of America, that's dollar bills, all right? And so with that in mind, let's be successful. If we're gonna do this thing, let's do it, right? And so if you notice, we've got close to 1,100 agents in our system now, right, with Future Home Realty, and we had 40 in the room, 42 in the room last night, and we've got, 25 in the room today, all right? So your competition is non-existent. We understand that, right? That those who decide to make this happen will make it happen, and that's the beauty of it, all right? So turn on your clicker, and here we go. First thing you need to talk about, this is gonna be our mantra, all right? Is that we overcomplicate things. This business is simple, all right? I'm telling you, this business is simple. It's not easy, all right, but it's simple. It takes work, okay? But it's a simple process. So I want you to just remember this. Here's your mantra. This is simple. I got this. All right? This is simple. I got this. I told, if you guys were at the office meeting the other day, yesterday, Samuel, my youngest son, the one that's adopted from Russia, he is struggling right now with some three-digit times two-digit multiplication concepts. I think I got it. We go to bed and wake up the next morning. I get a blank stare when I put a three times two in front of him, not three times two, but a three digit number and a two digit number, right? And he just, I'm like, and he's a smart guy, really smart guy, all right? Like I was telling the group yesterday at the office meeting, he's gonna be a great CIA operative. I guarantee he is, because he'll go to bed. I'll leave to go get milk or something like that later on that evening. And the garage is in the, we have basements in Tennessee, all right? Because I know anything you dig around here fills up with water. It's called an in-ground pool, all right? So, but down there we actually have, or up there we actually have basements. So the garage is in the lowest level and his bedroom's on the top level. So there's no way he could hear me. All of a sudden I'll walk out the next morning, take him to school, and he'll say, "Hey, where'd you go last night, Dad?" I'm like, "What are you talking about?" He's like, "Your tires aren't in the same spot they were when you parked last time." He pays attention to that kind of stuff. He's real intel, and he just memorizes stuff. He's from Russia, right? So if you ever play Hangman with Samuel, okay, let me give you a clue. You better bone up on Tchaikovsky, all right? Okay, that's his favorite. He's a Russian composer, so he's very proud of that, and it's a word that nobody else knows how to spell, and he gets everybody on Hangman that way, all right? So just heads up, if you play Hangman with Samuel, just be prepared. Just make sure you know how to spell Tchaikovsky. It's T-C-A something, H something. Okay. It's all in there, right? I still don't know. He gets me every time. All right. So what I started doing with him, though, Sammy, you're a smart guy, all right? This is simple. You got this. So now before we do any math, all right, it's, I'm smart, this is simple, I got this. I'm smart, this is simple, I got this, all right? And we repeat that mantra, and next thing you know, now it's simple, he's got this, all right? He's had to talk himself into that and give himself permission to succeed in doing that multiplication problem. I wanna give you permission and allow you to give yourself permission to succeed in this business, all right? You can. All right, I figured it out when I was 25 years old and had no direction whatsoever. All right, you can figure this out, all right? So When I say this is simple, your response to me is going to be, because I'm going to say it a lot, is going to be, I got this. So every time you hear me say this is simple, you're going to say, I got this. Good job. All right. Understand the power of the mind. The mind is critical, because without that, you're going to be stuck not being able to do three digits times two digits, right? Until the point you give yourself permission to do it. Now, this is important for me, because if you guys know, any guys newer enough that don't know my story, I didn't grow up in the most powerful, positive atmosphere growing up. So I've had to seek this out, right? And a lot of us aren't there, and that's okay. All right, and a lot of us aren't coming from, hey, look, I had this real uplifting, you know, background when I was growing up. I didn't. All right, I tell them this is not a joke. My dad, God bless him, he's now, you know, passed away, but had a what's plaque. It like a plaque? Thank you. Thank you. You knew it. All right. Okay, that's right. Okay. He had a plaque on his desk. All right, that says this: if everything seems to be going right, you've obviously overlooked something. Now, that's kind of a tough way to live, don't you think? Right? Yeah. You know, and so that's how I remember. Now, again, my dad had a lot of positive qualities, but, you know, instilling positive, you can do it, Bob, kind of attitude wasn't one of them, obviously, right? Because he couldn't get over himself. So with that in mind, some of us come to the table with that in our background as well. So let me help you get rid of those, all right? That's one of my goals, is to help you get rid of that, because this is simple.
I got it.
There you go. You guys got it. All right. We're going to learn to replace the fear and failure habits that have stopped us before. We're going to stop listening to the old us, all right? Stop listening to the old you. We're going to learn to pre-play what it's going to look like and feel like to achieve your goal. Sometimes, you know, people say, oh, just replay your past, you know, successes. Well, if I don't have any to draw from, well, let's pre-play them, all right? Let's pretend like they're there already and let's just pre-play them. We're going to talk through a lot of this stuff. We're going to be honest about where we are and where it's going to take us to be where we want to go. Here's where I talk about a map, all right? Let's just say $100,000 is the goal, right? That's, we're going to draw a map to go to $100,000 net. And you guys are all future home here, so it's easy for me to say, okay, $100,000 a year net means $104,000 gross, all right? It used to be $121,000 gross to get to 100, right? Yeah. Used to be 121 plus, right? All right, but now it's only 104. If you're Century 21, it was 200. All right, to get you to 100 net. All right, I used to joke because we had some Century 21 agents in the room. I said, stay where you are. God bless you, but do me a favor. If I'm going to help you get net to 100,000, that means I got to get you to gross 100, 200, I mean. That means your broker's going to make 100. Have them send me a gift card for peace sake. All right, have them buy me lunch at least, if nothing else, if I'm going to add 100 grand to his bottom line. All right, so for us, our goal is to gross 104, because the most you're going to pay us is 4, and you'll be done with your 100. All right? But if I'm going to draw you that map, where we're going to end up is an important part to put in the map, right? But just as important is where we're starting. So many times we start to draw this map, right? We'll get map being our goals or here's our business plan for the year or whatever the case is. And you start with the end in mind, which is what you should. By the way, if you missed the coffee chat, that's all we covered this morning at 7:30. What's breaking it down? Here's 100,000. We're going to break it down. What does that mean per transaction? You need to break it down to the smallest minutia piece. And you feel like, hey, you know what? I got to do one open house a week and make 5 phone calls a week. And I make 100 grand. It's that simple? It's that simple.
I got it.
Thank you very much. All right. Okay. All right. So, but with that in mind, to draw a proper map, you got to be honest about where you're starting, right? And all of us have a different starting point. So for me to help you get to the end game, I need to know what your end game is, but I also need to know where your start game is, right? And you got to be honest about where you are. And because we all have some rough edges that we need to rub off, right? Things we need to change about who we are, what we do, and the way we act, and say, hey, look, you know what? If I'm honest, I probably need to improve on this, that, or the other. Fair enough? All right, so we're going to work on that. And we're going to commit to being accountable for your actions. Holy smokes. Saying things like, I am where I am today because of choices I've made. I know that's un-American right now, okay? All right, it's very un-American to actually take personal responsibility for where you are, all right? But we're gonna be un-American if that's what we call un-American, all right? We're actually gonna take responsibility and say, you know what? I am where I am today because of choices I made. I can try and blame my dad all I want, all right? But holy smokes, you're 50 years old, get over it, Bob, all right? Obviously, I haven't. I still remember that plaque. Like, it's achievement. Kristen, I keep trying. All right? It's just like emblazoned, but I got to get rid of that, right?
Okay. You were like, he had a...
Yeah, right. See, and then she reminded, it's her fault. It's Karen's fault. She, it's all hers. Yeah, exactly. That's right. All right. So now this is one that we never like, right? It's kind of like the old, you guys remember Happy Days? All right, and Fonzie couldn't say wrong, right? I was right? Okay, being accountable is one we don't like to say either, right? But to be honest with you, all this training is going to be no different than anything. Well, there's some tweaks, all right, that I think is different than from what you might find anywhere else. But I guarantee, I can't hit a golf ball very far. Chris, I don't know if we ever played together, but you can probably attest to this if you ever, all right? But I can tee up a three wood right now and hit it in any direction and go find the ball, and wherever I go find that ball, there's probably another real estate training going on today, all right? I'm just telling you, and I don't hit it very far, all right? So there's something else happening. But here's the thing. If you went to that training and you were in the wrong room, hey, I thought I was in the whatever. If you did that, what they're teaching, it'd probably work. You know what I mean? The problem is we go and don't do, all right? The phrase we like to use at 100K is going bagel to bagel. All right? What does that mean? Realtors are famous for this. Let's get up. What am I going to do today in my business? I don't know. Let me go to a seminar. You go to a seminar, you eat a bagel. Except here, we don't have bagels. All right? We'll talk about that in a second. All right? But I go and I eat a bagel. And then what do? You learn something, and then you go home and you don't do it. All right? You go to sleep and you wake up the next morning and say, what am I going to do with my real estate business today? I don't know. Let me go to a seminar and eat a bagel. All right? And go learn something new again, and then don't do it. Right? But the reality is all of them would work if you would just implement, right? A lot of them would if you would just do it, right? So if we can decide that this is the year we're going to do it. Now, how do we do that? We're accountable, right? Why do people, guess what? The gym, all right, has weights and treadmills and ellipticals. We all know how to use them, right? Why do people hire personal trainers? Accountability, right? You know how to lift the weight. You know how to get on the treadmill. You know how to get on the elliptical, right? The reason we're willing to pay somebody $75 an hour is to say, get on the treadmill, right? Well, let's not do that. Let's be accountable to ourselves and to one other person, not pay them $75 an hour because you're going to be accountable to each other. All right, if you want to trade money, you give them $75, they give it back, all right, and you can call it, okay, we've paid each other, all right? If that works for you, all right, do it that way. But accountability is key, because that is why people, that's the difference in those who do and those who don't. A lot of starters, few finishers, all right? Check out the roles of any marathon, all right? Many more starters than finishers. And if you really want to get it, many more people started training for a marathon than even started the race, and fewer, even more, that Eve actually finished. Fair enough? All right, so we're going to focus on finishing. That's another mantra we're going to have. We're going to finish. All right, so here's the ugly truth. We're not going to spend the whole time on this, all right? Basically, I'm going to tell you that 80% of realtors out there made gross less than $46,000 in commission last year. It's the truth, all right? 20%, zero. Zero closings. Those are realtors. What does that mean? I mean, National Association dues-paying members, all right? Okay, these people are a nonprofit. They are a 501c3, okay? Because they made no commissions, yet they paid dues and everything else, so they have a net loss on their tax return right now. If you gave money to them, you could write it off on your taxes because they're a nonprofit, right? Okay, you could get to do that. $4,600, you're still a nonprofit, right? Because you know, by the time you pay board dues and pay your broker sum and all that kind of stuff, all right, you're losing money. 80%, so believe you, oh, there's so many realtors out there. So everybody, my competition, there's no way, you have no competition. 80% of your business, of your competition did nothing, right? They didn't, all right? So you don't have competition. Go out and be this person, all right? It's no different than any other industry. 80-20 principle, 20% of the people do 80% of the work. We all know that, right? Be the 20%. If we're going to do this, let's do it, right? Let's make it happen. Let's actually finish, all right? So the question is, which 20% are you? Now imagine this. We're going to just do a little mind game here. Imagine netting $100,000 in commission income, all right? Enjoying the real, what? Now that's it. Yeah, whatever, Bob. You can't have both, all right? You can't have your cake and eat it too. Yes, you can. This business can be fun because this business is simple. Yeah, you do, all right? enjoying the real estate. Here's the thing. When you get so busy that you get to choose the clients that you want to work with, it becomes very freeing, right?
Yeah.
When all of a sudden, because we all know that there are clients, everybody knows the clients you enjoy, right?
Yeah.
And there are also clients that we endure, right? How about if we got rid of the people we endured last year and only work with the people that we enjoy? All right. There's no need to be physically, morally, and emotionally, and verbally abused. Is there?
Yeah.
Right? You know what? Life's too short. Have a great day. All right. Here's my competitor's card. Go ask, you know, they're one of the 80%. Go call them. All right. Seriously. All right. And what happens is, though, right now is that we become so possessive of any client we have because it's the only client we have. So I understand your possessiveness. Right. That they're giving you every sign that they're trying to shrug you off, right? They're like, Karen, get off. I do not want to buy today, right? And you're like, oh no, I got a mortgage payment next month, right? That's what you're thinking. And so what if we were so busy that they're like, oh, please work with me, Karen. Like, you can get that busy that you can then you get to choose, you know, who and when you want, who you want to work with. All right. Controlling the transaction versus the transaction controlling you. All right. Stop running around with the chicken, your head cut off, trying to put out fires. All right. Just get under control. Right. Just begin to. It's easy. Yeah, it is. Okay, I said easy. It's simple is what I meant. All right. For once in your life, be true to your priorities, all right? We're going to learn to be true to our priorities. We all say, Bob, Chris, what are your priorities? Well, God, family, you know, my nonprofit work and da-da-da-da-da and all these other things. And then finally is, you know, my actual, you know, career. And then I look at your calendar, it's totally inverted, right? So we say the right things, we just don't do it, right? What if we could actually prioritize our life and get to a point where, hey, look, you know what? Work's part of it. I'm not saying work has to be the very bottom, because guess what? We need to eat, all right? My family is very happy that I work, right? Because they like to live in a house with a roof and everything else, okay? So it's important to do. How about we're going to teach you to discover your purpose in life, because none of us were put on earth to sell real estate. Can I tell you that? That was not, you did not come out of the womb, all right, saying that, you know what? I want to sell real estate. That's not our purpose. Here's the cool thing. There's a deeper purpose. A lot of us, it's, you know, some of us have deeper passions, all right? Something that really drives us, and it could be homeless people, orphans. It could be homeless animals. It could be crisis pregnancy people. It could be all sorts of things, right? The cool thing about real estate is it allows you to time and money, if done right, to go really affect change and do something really cool, all right, yet still providing a great lifestyle for your family and everything else that you want to do. All right, so we're going to learn to attack with a purpose. We're going to learn that there's a possibility of creating a residual income from this business. I preach this. We have another group that meets before our Tuesday night group called The Next. They're the people that have taken 100K, and they've already surpassed that, and they're ready for the next level, the next step. And what do I teach there? I teach them how to get out of the real estate business. Like, what? Why would you do that? There's always people out there to sell real estate, right? Well, I want them to start thinking like a business owner and say, here's one of the first things I teach in the first session there. You know what? Real estate agents, none of us get it right. No one ever taught me this. You go to Allstate school, all right, you're going to be an insurance person. What are they going to teach you to do? Build your book of business. Your goal is in 30 years to build it so big that you can sell it to a new Allstate agent coming in. And you actually have something that you can sell, walk away from. It's a willable, residual, it has a cap rate value analysis on it, and someone can pay you X amount of dollars because of the cash flow that that thing creates. Why don't we do that in real estate? We work hard building a book of people that know, like, and trust us that want to use our services, and then at the end, we're like, oh, I hope I, have another commission before I die, right? We're going to do this until death do us part, right? Let's figure out something else. Now, we also talk about investing and some other things that they can do to try and get to the point where they can walk away from it. But why would you walk away from a business you built without getting some monetary, you know, compensation for that? Yeah, we do it all the time, all right? So what if there was a way that we could create a residual from the real estate business? Because this is simple.
I got it.
Yeah, you do, all right? Okay, that sounds great, Bob. But I can see you looking. You see about 25 of us in the room, about 5-7 of us looking at me. Bullshit. Okay, heard this one before. That was at the seminar yesterday where I ate the bagel. They covered the same thing, all right? Okay. No, here's what's going to happen, all right? This is simple. I got this. We're going to study those who have done it. It's all. There's nothing new under the sun. I don't have the magic pill. I don't have oh guys, this is the greatest app. If you put this on your phone, you'll have so much business, you won't know what to do with it, all right? Because people can search the MLS by using your app. Great idea, go for it, have it. It's not gonna revolutionize your business, all right? It's none of that. It's not, hey, look, if you buy this Zillow zip code, this is the key. That might be the key, but it's only gonna work for one of you, all right? I want something that's gonna work for everybody, so how do I do that, all right? We're gonna learn from others in the room. We live in an abundance mentality at Future Home Realty, right? What does that mean? It means that there's plenty for all right? And because of that, we're willing to share because the thing I share today is the answer I get tomorrow, right? And so we're all, because the reality is the people who do business with Ben are completely different than the people who do business with Karen, all right? So there is no fear that we're gonna, if I share that, they might take a piece of my pie. That's my secret script, all right? And if that's the script that all of a sudden people will just start throwing money at me, all right, if I use that script. Okay, none of that, right, works because it doesn't exist, right? So because of that, we're going to learn from each other. We're going to submit to the law of the harvest. This is a God-given law that you can't argue with, all right? And it basically says this, whatever you sow, you will reap, period. I want 100 of them. Remember I told you I lost half of those 180 that came, all right? They wanted to reap without sowing, okay? You cannot cheat this law. Gravity, not a good one to try and cheat, right? Okay, the law of the harvest, don't try and cheat it. You can't reap what you haven't sown to begin with, right? So that's a positive thing or it could be a negative thing. You sow negative seeds, you're gonna get negative harvest, right? You sow positive seeds, you're gonna get positive harvest. So we just gotta agree that, you know what? There's a process to this and we've got to abide by that law. We can't cheat it. As much as you want to speed up the process, all right, sowing and reaping is a process, all right? It doesn't matter how magical, you know, outside of having Jack's magic beans, all right, things don't grow faster than they're supposed to, all right? We're going to learn from our mistakes. What does that imply? Got to make some, right? Make some mistakes. Go for it. Okay, have at it. You're all my agents. Go for it. You're my permission to make mistakes. Jim will deal with the problems later. All right? That's right. All right? Okay. That's right. Exactly. See? Good job. It's simple, Jim. All right. Good deal. Seriously, one of my favorite proverbs is this. Where there are no oxen, the stable is clean. Right? Now, when Solomon wrote that proverb, at that time in Babylon, having oxen meant wealth, right? So what he was saying is, when you're making things happen, sometimes it gets messy, right? But if nothing's happening, then you've got really clean stables. Really cool, but a clean stable means nothing's happening. Walk around, agents, hey, how's it going? Great, any problems on your deals? None, awesome, how many deals you got? None. Okay, that might be a sign, all right? No wonder you have no problems. To the converse of that, is it's okay when you got problems. I remember the other day, not the other day, it's probably a little while ago, walking through, one of the agents, can't remember who it was, said, Bob, every deal, man, it seems like every deal's got an issue. I said, good. He said, what? I said, good. I said, if there were no issues, why would they need us? That's the way you look at a problem, right? That's your chance to shine, right? Because if I could sell anything without separating myself from 6% of the gross profit, I would do it. And so would your clients, right? Why do they want to pay us? Oh, just because you passed the test, I think you're owed 6%. Well, screw that, right? Because a lot of times, by the way, the 6% that you want to separate them from is pretty much the sum total of all the equity they have in the thing. All right? And we look at it like, oh, no big deal, 6%. And they're like, oh, yeah, big deal. Right? You know, it's funny, the book Freakonomics, you should read the book sometime. It's kind of interesting. It's a really pretty light read. But in that, one of the study, they study different things, just kind of weird things that came across. But it was actually naturally attracted to me was a chapter on real estate sales. And they said that it's a fact, I can't remember the exact numbers, that real estate agents selling their own properties, right, sell them, it usually takes 34% longer, yet they get 15% more on average for the sale of their home. And he goes through the numbers. He goes, walk you through why. He's talking to the public, right? And in his book, he's talking to the public, and he says, here's a reality. An extra $10,000 to you as the homeowner is a big deal. An extra $10,000 to a realtor is $300. Because 6%, 10,000 is 600, right? And half of that, because it's usually split between two realtors, is 300. So you wonder why. Oh, first offer's best offer. Let's get this done. You know what I mean? All the realtors we're not going to see another better offer right now. But when they're selling their own home, whoa. That 10 grand is my 10 grand, right? 10 grand means 10 grand. 10 grand doesn't mean 300 anymore. And so it's a fact. They studied it. It takes them longer because they hold out for a better offer, yet they end up getting more money for the home. Okay? So realize that when we're going in. Okay, the other thing is, don't shy away at how much money we make for doing what we do. I know it's hard, all right? But it ain't that hard. Matter of fact, it's simple.
Yeah,
it is. Okay? Here's the reality. You think life's hard because your appraisal didn't come in? Okay? Go watch a guy roofing in July here in Florida. All right? With tar. Let's do the tar roof, commercial roof. All right? Go get an iced tea for 99 cents, all right? Sit in your air-conditioned luxury vehicle watching the guys mow the median, and you tell me how tough you got it. Didn't appraise. I don't know what to do. Figure it out, right? What are we paying you for? And if you're flipping out, by the way, all right, because it didn't appraise, certainly don't flip out in front of your client. They're like, holy smokes, what am I paying you for? I thought you'd done this before. All right? Okay? Holy, you know, what are we doing here? So you got to stay calm and make things happen, but be glad for the problem. Because the problem is why we exist, right? This is one of our value adds. We got to grow personally. We're going to teach you how to stop chasing business and start attracting it. Right? It's a better way to live. It's a better way to go about this business. Who wants to chase business? Nobody. You know why you don't want to chase it? Because you don't want to be chased when you're on the other side of the transaction, right? And so because of that, let's attract business rather than chase it. Now, in order to attract business, we have to be attractive, all right? Does that mean physically? Yeah, some. It means physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, all these things. You've got to walk around like you have your stuff together, right? Because who wants to do business with somebody that's been weaned on a pickle? Right? Holy smokes, man. Jeez. And we know them, right? They're the 80%. They're the 80% who make no money, right? That's, oh, I gotcha. Yeah, okay. Phil, jeez, Chris, you guys. We're going to feed off the synergy in the room. Here's what happens with synergy, all right? Especially on Wednesdays when we clean it up, all right? Is that we feed off the synergy in the room. Because here's what happens. All of a sudden, we start to grow together. Things are starting to happen. People are doing some things. And, okay, this sounds harsh, but it's reality, right? Someone's looking over here and say, someone raises their hands. Yeah, I had 3 open houses, and I actually met, and I'm working with 2 new buyers that I had never met a week ago, and I've actually got some things happening in my business, and things are really starting to pop. All right, and somebody on this side of the room says, that person did it? Whenever you're talking out of the side of your mouth, it means it's usually not a good thing, right? Okay, my mom was infamous. My mom was now passed away, too. My mom was infamous from talking out of the side of her mouth, but she usually would talk about the person to the side of the mouth to the person. She'd talk out of the wrong side of her mouth. Mom, I'm over here. Oh, yeah. And she's talking about the lady next to me. You see her? Mom, you're talking to the lady. All right? So God bless her heart, right? So we're going to feed off the synergy in the room, because what happens, it happens positively and negatively. It's motivating. It's like, really? If they can do it, I can do it. Holy smokes, right? And we can get that, start making that happen. We're going to stop making and accepting your own lame excuses, because you do it all the time, all right? So if, by the way, I should have said this at the very beginning and saved yourself, you know, a good solid, you know, 30 minutes already. If you want to be coddled and, you know, told it's okay, and the fact that you've made where you are and where you are, it's all right, and it's really not your fault, and go get a safe room, all right, or whatever they call it for the after the people, you know, surviving the election results and all that kind of stuff, all right? If you want one of those, this isn't the room, okay? Sorry, not here, all right? Okay, save the drama for your mama, all right? Okay, we don't want to hear it here. We're not going to accept your excuses, so stop making them, all right? So if you want to make excuses and find it, that's the other Hampton Inn, all right, wherever that is, all right? Go to that one, all right? Live in accountability. There it is again, all right? We're going to be accountable to each other, all right? Because we're going to actually make things happen, because we're going to finish this time. We're not going to just start. We're going to finish the marathon, all right? This is the time. We're going to turn off the television. Turn it off. No, the only time I really have the TV on anymore is usually when I'm at the gym and I'm on the elliptical or doing something, right? And so, and I shouldn't even do it then. I put something on my, you know, go listen to a good sermon, all right, that's on my, you know, an MP3. Do something else. But I get caught, and all of a sudden, by the time I get off, I'd say, boy, I just got done exercising, but I think I've got disease. I have Crohn's disease or mesothelioma, I think, you know. I've never lived in West Virginia, but I think I should sue somebody, all right? Okay, and so that's what I'm saying. Literally in the 45 minutes on the elliptical, I'm like, holy smokes, I feel terrible, right? What happened? I got to turn that thing off, man.
That's when you record.
There you go. See, that's right. Go la, 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 la. I don't want to hear it. Exactly. I need to just turn the channel. Can you think I'd figure that one out, right? Okay. But I'm like, holy smokes, are people really listening to this stuff and convincing themselves that they've got this, that, and the other? All right. I've got, you know, men, for Pete's sake, we'll clean it up. But, you know, if you listen to TV long enough, you've got high cholesterol and low energy. It was like, gee, many Christmas, man. You get... You know, and they show a guy sitting over his fourth bowl of ice cream, like, yeah, you think? All right? Okay. You know, so we're going to turn that off, all right? We're going to stop listening to that other garbage. We're going to find ourselves to fill ourselves with other stuff. All right? We're going to live a disciplined life. One of my favorite phrases that we talk a lot about here is there's freedom in structure. It's a great line. There's freedom in structure. The more structured we are, the freer we become. Give me an example of that. I have learned over the last 10 years, all right, become very structured in my finances. It was a learned process for me. Jeanette and I have been married 26 years, all right? I said the last 10, all right? It took her 16 years to, you know, beat me down, all right? But I've become very structured. And I'm not even saying the beautiful thing is guess what? What's today, January 4th, all right? January 1 at 12:01 a.m., I hit a button. And my taxes were done. Because guess what? I did my taxes every step along the way. Every transaction was just entered as it was. It's the old, when you go to these organization seminars, you pay somebody $18,000 or whatever to go teach you how to live a disciplined life, right? And you fly to Texas, and what do they say? Touch something once. What do they mean? It means if you're going to file it later, why not file it now, right? Really? I paid you 18 grand for that? Right? That's all they're teaching you. Do it. You're going to have to pay the piper, right? Pay him now, pay him later, whatever. Do it now. But if you just, every time I write a check or every time I pay a bill, it's coded to something, guess what? It's done. My taxes are done, right? Because it's already, live your life that way. And take that and apply that to multiple things in our lives. The more structured we become, the freer it becomes. All right? We're going to talk about ways that we can do that. Actually implement this time. Finish. All right? Don't just go bagel to bagel. All right? We're going to do it. That means implement. Right? We're going to apply something that we're going to learn, and we're going to finish. We're not going to start. Here's what I know. All right? We still have some empty seats here. When you come, those of you who do come back next time, because we're going to meet again in 2 weeks, those of you who do come back next time, bring somebody, because half the people that are here today won't be here. All right? I'm just telling you. Which one is it? I don't look to your left or your right. One of the two. All right? Okay? All right? Won't be here. All right? What's that? Yeah, right. Well, I don't know. Okay. He'll set up his camera and leave. All right? Okay. So we're going to actually implement this time. We're going to finish, all right? Trust the process. This is one of the things. We're going to just say, you know what? The process works. The process works. The process works. Okay? You may not be getting immediate results, but the process works. I'm going to trust the process. Trust the process. However, we're going to consistently evaluate our progress. Because if what we're doing ain't working after a while, we need to change.
Right?
Because we're measured on results. It's the Yoda, right? There is no try, only do. Because trying doesn't get it. Trying is safe room stuff. I try. I've tried to make it. Real estate's hard. Everybody's. This is the time of the year, end of the year. People, board dues are due, right? So we start to see people, oh, I don't know if real estate's for me. And board dues are due. We get it. Okay. All right. What does that mean? Well, I don't know. I've done everything I can. Really? Let's talk for a minute. No, let's not talk. I've done everything I can. Yeah, okay, well, all right, that's fine. That's your perception. And then pretty soon, tears. I've done everything I can. Okay, I get that, all right? Save the drama for your mama. That's the other Hampton Inn. I told you that. Get out of here, all right? We're actually not. Jim's nicer. That's why I have Jim do this. All right? It's like, really? I don't remember seeing 100K, all right? I don't remember seeing 100K, all right? Did you really do everything you can? I don't know. I didn't feel like you guys are so big, you can't support us, and I can't get the personal attention. So, well, I didn't come to your house. I will admit that, all right? But I was around, all right? Okay? Anyway, so consistently evaluate progress. That's our trip to the moon. This is the one we love, all right? It's a great slide. We talk about a trip to the moon a lot and also weeding yourself, all right? But here's a trip to the moon. Here's our perception. Trip to the moon looks like this. They shoot a rocket, it lands on the moon. Pretty cool, huh? All right, pretty easy. They just did one calculation at the beginning, say, fire it away, that's where it'll land. That's our perception. Here's reality. This box represents a 10-second, let's say a 5-second portion of that trip, and we blew it up 10,000 times, that's what that trip looks like. Because they are constantly, realtors, here's a big January, which is January 4th, all right? You guys are all, this is your week. You get your cup of coffee, got your new planner, this is the year. You know what? Because I got this really cool leather-bound journal this time. This is the year, all right? I'm going to write my goals, and we're going to make it because I've got this leather-bound one, all right? The old spiral one, nobody wants to commit to goals when you have that unless you have the Hulk, all right? Okay, now that you can commit to right there, all right? That's one that you can hang with, all right? But we talk ourselves into all sorts of excuses, right? Oh, I didn't have the right journal last year. Okay, or you didn't follow it, one of the two, right? Here's the thing. Realtors, January 1, I got your cup of coffee, you went to the beach because you live in a great area here, right? It's a great place to goal set, right? So you go to the beach, you're going to goal set, you're going to set, here's what I'm going to vision, whatever the last seminar you went to, okay? If you went to, it was goal setting, it was vision casting, it was whatever you called it, right? So you're going to set, here's my tone for the year. You get it all written down, that's a great plan, and it could be, right? And then you put it away, and then I ask you, how's your plan going in July? And you're like, where'd that go? Dang, was it in, no, wasn't that one. Was it this? No, all right. And all of a sudden you do find it, all right? And it's under the other 4 stack of books that you're supposed to have read by now that you haven't read, all right? So you move those out of the way and then you find it and you say, oh man, I was supposed to have 18 sales done by now. How many you got? 2. Ooh. Wow. Okay, so 18, I was supposed to do 36 for the year. I'm halfway through. I've done 2, so I do 34. You know what? That bartending gig wasn't that bad, right? Cutting hair, that was all right. At least I had some money coming in, right? That's what your mind goes, right? It starts to do that. So what we're going to do is we're going to catch you before you get to that point. We're going to evaluate our progress more often. We're going to do it. We're going to teach once a week. We call it the Sunday night ritual, where you're going to take a Sunday night and you're going to spend 20 minutes. You're going to spend 10 minutes evaluating your previous week, and you're going to take, based upon those results, you're going to take 10 minutes and plan your next week. Did you hear me? Plan? What's that? I thought I was supposed to wake up tomorrow and find the next bagel to eat. All right? No. We're actually going to have a plan of how we're going to attack this business, and we may need to make small tweaks. So let's say we had broken it down to the smallest microcosm. Let's just spit 4 open houses this month and do 20 phone calls to people I know. All right? And that means each week, 1 open house and 5 phone calls to people I know. Well, if I did my Sunday night ritual, I found out I did my open house. Good job. Give yourself a thumbs up, emoticon, or whatever that's called. Okay? All right, give yourself one of those. But you found you only made 4 phone calls. Right? I was supposed to make 5. I made 4. I'm supposed to make 5 next week. I'm a math teacher. How about if we do 6? Because 6 + 4 = 10 divided by 2. I'm back on track. Pretty easy tweak. That's one of these. Small little adjustment, right? Waiting till July 1st to find out that you're supposed to have made 130 phone calls by now, right? And you've made 4. You're like, oh, crap. Right? That's a big YouTube. And the reason we call it a trip to the moon, you know why they do it this often? Because on a trip to the moon, if they waited, it takes 2.5 days. Let's check it in a day. Yeah, we'll check in 36 hours. We'll do a halfway check, see where we are. All right? Okay? Yeah. They're over here, too far, too late, can't escape, irrecoverable. Is that a word?
It is now,
absolutely. Well, that's one time. Irrecoverable, irrecoverable. The third time, now it's a word, all right? Okay, you can't recover from that, right? And that's where we get on July 1st when we're supposed to have made 130 phone calls and we've made 4. Okay, we say, oh, I can't recover from that. It's a story of my push-ups. Remember in June? Here's what happened in June. You want to hear my excuse? All right? Lame. I told you I'm lame. Here it is. Ready? Kids got out of school. We went on vacation. I got sick. I'm in a different hotel room. We don't want to do my push-ups in front of everybody. All sorts of reasons. I could figure it out. Whatever. You know, I don't know. I didn't like the commercial. All right? So I can't do my push-ups today. Right? So I didn't do them. So I took the whole month of June off. Right? Now I'm stuck. I'm supposed to do, I was 120 sets of push-ups behind. All right? And I felt like quitting. I felt like saying, you know what? Shoot. I did 5 months. Right? 5 months, that's better than Chris. How many push-ups do you do? Right? See? All right? I'm better than him. Right? That's what we do, don't we? We compare ourselves to the wrong people. Yeah, compared to my neighbor, he's a slug. Right? Okay. And look, he's been in jail 4 times. I wasn't in jail, at least. Right? I mean, we choose the wrong people to compare ourselves to. Right? Right? And so, with that, my neighbor wasn't in jail 4 times. Right, by the way. Yours might have been, though, was it? I don't know. I never know. Do one of those checks. You never. Yeah, exactly. Ignorance is bliss. All right. But the thing is that we love to compare ourselves to the wrong people. So what happened is I said, no, I'm going to do it. So then what I did, it was kind of a bigger tweak than I wanted to make. I should have made it sooner, right? But I said, all right. And so for the next 2 months, I did 6 sets to catch up. So I was doing 4 sets of 50 each day. Next thing you know, and it was a pain, but I got caught back up. All right. And it wasn't totally irrecoverable, felt that way, all right? But I got to the point where I got caught back up. Now, throughout the time, all right, I was supposed to do 4 sets a day. There were times that I had done 2, all right? So I had 2, I hit my bed, my head hit the pillow. I'm like, okay, I've done 2. Dang, come on. All right, I got 2 options here. 2 more days, I can do 5, right, and get caught back up. Or I can get out of bed right now, do at least 1, all right, 1 set, and that way I only have 1 more day of 5, all right? So about half the time I did that, half the time I didn't, all right? But every simple, it was just small tweaks, right? And I say nothing to other than to do, we need to do this on everything we do, right? We need to be accountable to ourselves and make small tweaks along the way so that we can make the proper adjustments so we don't get to the point where it can't recover anymore, all right? So, teach you 2 systems. I told you back in the day in 2008 when I first taught this, I taught the only system, and that was this, called planting corn. It wasn't even called that at the time. It wasn't even called system 1 because there was only 1 system. So it was called the system. All right, so now it's system 1 called planting corn. Why do we call it planting corn? Because it's fast. Everybody seen corn? Everybody planted corn before? Okay? Love it. Plant corn late May, early June. All right? Supposed to be, is it head high by 4th of July?
Knee high by the 4th. Knee
for knee high? You got to grow. You got to hang out with my
team. That's Northern Wisconsin.
Okay, so you would know then. All right, Jim, Northern Wisconsin. You know that? Okay. Did you? All right. She's a Wisconsinite. Did you know that?
I did not know.
See,
that.
Look at that. Jim's a Wisconsinite.
Illinois.
Same thing. Illinois?
No, we had
a Wisconsin. Okay. All right. Very good. All right. So here's the deal. You plant corn, And after it pops through the ground, you can almost watch it grow. It's pretty fast, right? It's really such a boom. And next thing you know, it's by late July, early August, you're pretty much eating corn. All right? It's amazing how fast the sow to reap cycle is. That's the great news about corn. All right? Here's the bad news about corn. To harvest it, you chop it down. All right? And once you chop it down, you come back to that field next year and you say, field, where's my corn? And the field says, where's my seed? Where's my water? Where's my fertilizer? Where's the work that you put in? You're like, really? Every year? You know, come on. What's the deal? It's an annual, not a perennial. All right? Now, the reason we call it corn planting also is because and the reason we teach this is because I usually have people in the room, all right, that look at me and say, Bob, let's see, I could use a commission yesterday. All right? They need something that's quick sow to reap. All right? This is that. I'm going to teach you how to do it. So here's the deal. Remember this. This is simple.
I got this.
Good. All right? Let's do things backwards. The other training where I went and tracked down the golf ball, I told you that most of it's the same. Most of it is. All right? But a little small tweak here, because when we go to that training, they're going to teach you this. If you're going to last in this business, you better
list.
Have to, right? List. If you're going to last, you better list. Matter of fact, isn't it?
You don't last.
That's right. Isn't it in, I think it's in, there's written into chapter 475 of Florida statutes, isn't it? All right, isn't it in there? That if you're going to last, you better list, okay? I think they passed a law where it's now part of the Florida statute, chapter 475. Well, this one law we're going to break. Because if you want to plant corn, I'm going to teach you to work with buyers. How what? I'm just telling you, this is sow to reap quick, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Qualified buyer, ready to buy, who wants to buy, all right? Not giving you every other sign that says I don't want to buy, all right? Who wants to buy, who needs to buy, all right? And needs to close in the next 45 to 60 days is a check waiting to be cashed. It's an ear of corn waiting to be eaten. All right? Great. That's super. But it's corn. Yeah, chop it down. All right? It's an annual. It's not a perennial. I get all this. All right? Some of us need a lot of corn right away. Let's store it up for a little while, okay? And then we'll work on the other. Because here's what happens. We're going to do traffic generating events. What is that? Okay. Anywhere I can get eyeball to eyeball with people, right? Because eyeball to eyeball wins every time. National Association of Realtors study says 85% of the people do the business with the first person that walks through the door. I mean, that they come eyeball to eyeball with. First person they can get eyeball to eyeball with wins. Notice I said eyeball to eyeball, not pixel to eyeball. Right? Yeah, but if I really get this really cool Facebook ad, I guarantee that will be the secret. You are a pixel to them. I love to tell a story, Chris Light. Chris Light was in this class first time last session, all right? Now, there's a dude that we were talking this in our lunch and learn the other day he's 17, he's not that old, but 17 years in the public system, was a manager, all right? Finally got fed up and said, all right, that's it, I'm going to do it, and had his real estate license, but just committed, said, I'm all in. He's got 4 kids at home, all right? Blended family, and he's got a big bear chasing him, right? He left the security of a public's, you know, job. Something's going on, right? There was a story, and we told the story about burning the boats. You ever heard that? I don't know if it's really a true historical story or not, but it's about burning the boats. It's, a Greek warrior. He takes his army and they're going to go attack this island, and they get on the island, and all of a sudden their intel was bad because they get on the island and they're outmanned like 5-1. All right? It's bad intel. All right, we got this. This is simple. I got this. All right? They didn't say it with much passion, though, right? So what does he do? He orders, goes back and sends 5 guys back to the 5 ships and orders them to burn the ships. It's called burn the boats, right? They get back, and now where are you? These guys seeing the boats burn? There was their escape. Right? There you go, one way or another. It's conquer or die, right? Okay? And I joked that Chris was in a conquer or die situation. He had burned the boats, right? So he goes out and he starts doing these open houses, and we'll talk about the type of open houses in a second. Starts doing these open houses. He meets this guy on the very first day. Guy says, yeah, you can help me out, VA buyer, you know, that he can help get in for zero money down and everything else. Guy works it out and loves it. He goes to USAA to go get qualified for his mortgage. Guy gets in, he says, no problem, qualified for your mortgage. Oh, by the way, calls up Chris. Hey, Chris, by the way, thanks. I got qualified for USAA. We're good to go. By the way, the guy at USAA told me that if I use one of their preferred realtors, that they give me 1% back, and yada, yada, it starts. And Chris is like, crap. Dadgum. Because Chris knows one of two things is going to happen, right? He's either going to, A, lose the business, or B, have to match that 1% give up, right? That's just the way it goes. But catch this. Next line out. But you know what I told him, Chris? Nah, I don't need that. I've got Chris. I've met Chris. Eyeball to eyeball one. Chris didn't even have to go there because he was prepared to give up the 1%. You know he was. You know you would have. I would have. Absolutely. It's like, okay, whatever. I'll match it. All right. Okay. Too easy to just give that up, right? But no. The guy said, you know what? I shook Chris's hand. All right. I know Chris. I trust Chris. And he only met him for 22 minutes at an open house. Right? But it works. I'm just telling you, when you get eyeball to eyeball, it will win every time over your coolest billboard, no matter what shoulder you threw your jacket over on your photo. Right? Okay? It doesn't matter. I've tried it. I tried one billboard like this. That didn't get it. So I tried one billboard like this. All right? That didn't get it. All right? It doesn't matter. All right? You don't need to advertise and do all this stuff. You should go meet people. We call them traffic generating events. They're all sorts of things. We like to talk a lot about this. Bank-owned open houses. What? Bank-owned open houses. Why? Give you a quick story. So, I am 1 week into the real estate business. High school math teacher got out, started doing real estate with this huge company called Summit America Real Estate that wasn't around. That wasn't around the week before I got in the business, and it's not around now. All right? I was talking to the guy who sold me my home. It was a brand new home. And he was going out, getting his general real estate broker's license, had that, was starting a general real estate company. He said, Bob, while you're teaching, why don't you get your real estate license at night and you can sell in the summer and see how it works. It's a great idea. Let me go for it, okay? Got tired of teaching because teaching, the harder I worked, the same money I made, all right? And the less the guy next to me worked, the more money he made because he had been a teacher 20 years longer than I had. I said, something's broken here, so I'm going to try and do something different, all right? I want to get paid, compensated for what I do. So I started working hard, and I dug into it. And the very first weekend in the business, I said, Dave, I'm ready. I got my license. Summer's here. I got 10 weeks to make this work before I have to, you know, and probably about 6 weeks before I have to tell him I'm not coming back or I am coming back to teach. Let's go. What do I do? He said, go sit in an open house. I said, great. He said, where? I said, where? He said, at my our listing. I said, okay, our listing? He said, well, it's really my listing, but it's the only listing the office has. It's my aunt's house. I said, oh, great. Okay? All right. So here we go. So I sit in an open house, right? I'm there, and I'm ready, okay? And both Saturday and Sunday, sat them both because I'm ready to attack the real estate world, and I met three people, okay? Neighbor next door, all right? Lady across the street five doors down, okay? Neither wanted to buy, just were kind of nosy, right? This one dude walked in and said, really? You think? I said, hey, man, absolutely. Oh, I'd love to live here. This is awesome. Great. Perfect. Get him with the lender, right? On the phone right then and there. All right. I get on the lender. He said, run. I said, what? He said, I just did a felony report on the dude. Run. No, I'm just kidding. The guy couldn't get a library card, much less a mortgage. He said, hey, look, this guy's kind of a work, you know, maybe in about 17 years we might be able to get him qualified, but not now. All right. I said, okay. All right. I said, all right, so 1 weekend gone. Now what do I do? I said, so I was stuck. So I said, Dave, what do I do? He said, we'll figure it out. I said, well, that's easy for you to say, but I've got to figure something out. I've got 9 weeks now, right, to get this thing. So what I did, this is 1993. So I went to Google. No, that wasn't that. I got on the internet. No, it wasn't that. I reached out via email. No, that wasn't that. I went to the newspaper. You guys know what that is? Yeah. Ink. You've seen those before?
Yep.
How many of you weren't born in 1993? Some of you? I love it. Okay. All right. I had one last night that wasn't. All right. And that was good. Okay. But I did have one last night that was not born in 1993. It was awesome. All right. So I had to tell them what a newspaper was. So I was actually going through the real estate section of the St. Petersburg Times before it was called, it's changed names now, right?
Tampa Bay Times.
Yeah. So St. Petersburg Times. And in the real estate section on Friday, they had this list, housing and urban development. All right, list of government-owned properties for sale. So there's like a list of 15 of them there. I said, what are these? And I was reading through. All of a sudden, it says, contact your local HUD broker. So I asked my broker, hey, are we a local HUD broker? He says, what's a local? I said, okay, I guess we're not. All right, so I went down to Tampa, downtown Tampa, on Cass Street, fifth floor of a federal government building, all right? And they were very helpful there. You have a government? They were just like, oh, yeah, come on in. Let me show... Or I had to sit there and sift through about 3 hours of getting to the right window, right? And finally got to some, there you go. Finally got to somebody who handed me an inch and a half thick manual and said, here's our manual. All right, so I'm reading through this thing, trying to figure out how to get my broker to be a HUD broker, right? So I'm reading through this, and I'm about 3/4 of the way through, and I'm filling out some of the paperwork for him, and all of a sudden it says, by the way, any real estate agent is allowed to sit open houses at any of our properties. Here's how you do it. All right, so what the heck? Maybe that'll work, right? So I start looking up. You got to look up. You got to call and reserve a time and this, that, and the other. Then you got to get your signs. Your signs have to say government resale open house, period. They have to be 18 by 24. Very government, right? Got to be exact size. Can't say this. Can't mention foreclosure. Can't have my phone number on it. Can't any of that stuff, right? Has to exactly that. So I get those. I invest my whole $128 marketing budget on these 6 signs that say government resale open house, all right? I schedule it. I remember like it was yesterday. It was a subdivision. Can't remember the name of it. It was right off of Belcher, just south of East Bay, right? So I'm driving down Belcher. I record, you know, reserved. I had a Saturday time to sit there. And I said, all right, I got nothing else to do. Because the whole week before, Jeanette was working a full-time job, right? We had no kids. She's coming home saying, hey, I got to go today. I'm like, great. What'd you do? Oh, working hard. Yeah, I was like, I don't know. I'm panicked, right? I'm making no money. I got a check coming in from teaching because I elected to get paid all summer, right? But I was still like, oh my gosh, what am I doing? All right, so I just go drive around. What'd you do? Oh, familiarizing myself with the neighborhoods, right? Okay, just I was trying to figure out something I could actually justify my existence in her mind, right? And so I finally had something to do. So I got up like at 8:30, and I was out on the road. I was going to start this open house at 9 a.m. Right? So I get there and I put my 2 signs out on Belcher. All right. It was perfect. Drive in like 2 streets down, pull over to the first corner so I can go put my next sign out. All right. Pop the trunk, get out of the car. Car pulls behind me. All right. So we kind of made eye contact. We kind of nod a little bit. All right. I grew up in Southern California, but not the OC. Okay. That you see on TV. I grew up in, it wasn't the hood. It was the edge of the hood though. All right. It was right there. Okay. And so I kind of, you know, I'm a little cautious. So I had my head on a swivel a little bit. I'm making eye contact with this guy. He didn't look like the nicest guy in the world. So we just kind of, you know, nodded a little bit, put my sign out, drove up to the next corner, got out, pulled over, popped my trunk, 2 cars pulled behind me. All right. So now I'm like, what in the, so I put that sign in, right? Go drive up. That was the street the house is on. Go down 5 houses down on the left, pull in, 3 cars in before I could even open the door. That day, I met 36 people. Said, Now, I mean, I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but 36 in one day is better than 3 in 2, right? And my odds, I think, if I can do this, I bet you I can, my chances are better of finding somebody who might want me to help them, right? That day, I ended up meeting. So fast forward, 8 weeks later, all right, time to make a decision whether I'm going to go back to teaching or not. 4 closed, 4 more already under contract, all right? All from people I met at government HUD foreclosure open houses. Now, before you get too excited, all right, the average sale price of those was probably about $53,000, all right? But it was a start, and it was already going to essentially get close to paying for the first half of my year of teaching. I said, all right, if I got that covered, all right, I can do this. This is simple. Yeah, that's what I said to myself. despite what that plaque said on my dad's thing. All right? This is simple. I got this, so I can figure this out. So I started doing it. And by the way, of those eight that were under contract, okay, do you know how many of them I sold the house I was sitting in? Zero. All right? They come up to me and say, why are you sitting out on the porch? I say, you go inside and you tell me. All right? You ever smell the HUD foreclosure? All right? You know what? You don't want to be in there 10 minutes, and I certainly don't want to be in there for 5 hours. All right? So that's why I'm out here. But that's not going to fit what you were looking for? Great. What can I help you find? But what did you say? What was the script? I said, hi. How you doing? Sup. That was my script. Ready? Write this one down. Ready? Sup. All right? Say that when they walk in the door. All right? That's as simple as it got for me. How's it going? How can I help? Right? How do these work? And I just started meeting people, right? And I'd lived there for a year. It wasn't like I had, because I know you got into real estate because you want to wear a Rolex, drive a Jag, and be part of the country club. All right? God bless you. Go sit enough foreclosure open houses, and maybe you can. All right? But that's not where I started. All right? That's just not, and if you got that already, great. We have a Winter Park office in Orlando. A totally different animal over there. You guys been to Winter Park? Snooty. Jiminy Christmas. I'm like, holy smokes. They're like, oh, we don't do things under 900,000 here. It's like, really? That's about 48 of my closings, all right, added up. See? All combined, that might get to 1 million, all right? That's just kind of where I was rolling. That's right, exactly. That's right. So, now, only bank-owned open houses? I don't care what works for you, quite frankly. Just go get in front of people. If you got a regular open house that meets 36 people, if you got 36 people that show up at your house while you're watching Law and Order reruns, God bless you. All right? Figure it out. If you got that figured out, you did a trick I didn't, because I would have done it. I like Law and Order. All right? I would have watched that if I could have found 36 people to show up at the place where I was doing it. I just couldn't do it. So I was going where they were, right? And I went and met people, and I allowed this to happen. I got really good at converting walk-in traffic into business. I got really good at saying sup. I had that down like pat, all right? I had different ways of saying it, all right? Sup. Sa! Those were the greatest commercials ever, all right? We gotta bring those. I gotta Google that. They're out there, I bet, on YouTube. Yeah. Remember those? Yeah. That and the lizards. Remember the lizards when Budweiser had those lizards?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
They were really good as well. I don't know why they went away from that. All right? Now I get to, that's when commercials, back in my day, a commercial was a commercial. Now it's all about Crohn's disease.
Yes.
All right. Should I say that? Is Crohn's, is that like a female-male thing? Or is that?
No.
Okay, good. All right, so that's, I can say it works for both? All right, good. All right. I won't say it. All right. That's right. Yeah. Understood. All right. So we're going to get really good at converting walk-in traffic. Now, here's the best way to do that. You ready? Do it. How do I get good at that? Practice. How do I practice it? Do it. All right? Hey, I'm just telling you. You just go and you figure it out. And here's the beauty. When you're meeting 36, you can screw up all the time. Screw up on 35. All you need is one. Right? All you need is one. Because after a while, it gets that easy. All right? Because it is simple.
I got this.
Good. Okay. Very good. You're going to become an expert in investor buying. Okay, why not? You said bank-owned open houses, you're gonna meet investors. Mm-hmm. Right? Why do people come to the bank-owned open houses more? It's the perceived value of a deal, right? They think they're gonna steal a home. Trust me, I learned early what infomercials were out there. I hadn't even seen them, all right? But one of the three people that followed me into the first one said, hey, is this one of those houses I could buy for $1? I said, I don't think so. I was like, yeah, I was watching a show at 2:30 in the morning. Well, there's a reason on 2:30 in the morning, all right? But they said you could buy houses. I said, well, I don't know. And he said, well, how do these work? And I had the HUD manual with me. So why don't you guys take a look around? I was trying to figure out how these work. How do you buy one of these? How do you bid on one? I'm like, hang on a second. I'm only 3/4 of the way through the book, right? I'm trying to figure this out. I don't know. All right? But I'll get you the answer. I'll figure this out. We'll make it happen. So you're just going to look for ways that you can meet people. Become an expert in investor buying. I got really good at this. By the way, we'll teach a class, and we have one recorded. It's on our YouTube channel, how to speak the language of an investor. Totally different language, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. They don't care that you've got 18 by 18 tile, mm-hmm. all right? So stop advertising that way to an investor. If you're talking to an investor, he wants to know about what is the rate of return, what is his cap rate based upon the current rents, period. That's it, all right? What's my return on this thing? All right, so we're gonna learn to speak that language. We're gonna work first-time home buyers with vigor. Love first-time home buyers. Love them. Why? They refer the ever-loving daylights out of you. They're loyal as all get out, and they're social media geniuses. By the time you get home from the stinking closing, you look, and by the time they've tweeted and beat it and Facebooked and Snapchatted and whatever they do, all right? The reach is 15,000 people and know that they've got just bought a home. And there's a picture of the HUD closing statement and you with the key. All right? Like, hey, who's that next to you? All right? Oh, that's my realtor, Karen. Okay? I'm just telling you, like, holy smokes, what would a billboard cost you to get that kind of exposure? Right? So do that and let them just shout from the rooftops. By the way, we're going to talk about going old school for a minute here. All right? Here's the deal, old school versus new school. Back in the day, 1993, no internet, no email, so Chris Meyer will attest to this. Prudential Brilliant Realty, we were at Prudential Brilliant together, all right? It has now become a Coldwell Banker eventually, right? Okay, kind of matriculated into that, all right? So back in the day, Chris and I were at Prudential. So when I was getting these people, I would say, okay, this doesn't work for you. You don't like the dog smell? Eau de perro. All right, okay. All right, I get it. All right, so how will we find you something else? All right, so let's go. What do you want? Well, I'm looking for at least a two-bedroom, at least a two-bath. I need to be north of Wilmerton, south of Alderman, on the west side of 19. Great, no problem. So I'd write all that down in a notebook. All right, okay. Got it, had my little columns there, everything they're looking for. I'd go back to the office, say, hey, no problem by, you know, where, you know what, I catch up with all you to drop it off tomorrow at your house, or it would be better to drop it off at work on Monday. Work on Monday's great. Okay, perfect. So I get all that, write it all down. I'd go back to the office that night, put in their details, okay? John and Susan Smith, all right? Two bedroom, two bath, da-da-da, put in all the parameters, do a search, all right? Hit search. And then it would start printing.
Wait a minute, where did you go do the search?
At the office.
From the book.
No, oh, yeah, no. See, you get, yeah. There were computers when I got there. All right, Chris outdates me a little bit. Okay, but the books were still around. But they did have. But here's the bad news about the computer, right? Is that you couldn't select like which it just started printing.
Really?
All right. Okay, yeah, exactly. And it was a pin fit. Remember, you know those pin fed printers? I hear that in my sleep still. All right? You know what I'm talking about, right? It's just, that's right, exactly. Yeah, when you logged on, it was okay, I'm finally in. Nobody make a call. All right? I'm doing a search. So this thing's printing, right? And it's on that perforated paper, and the listings were never separated on the perforated paper, right? So where the perforation was halfway through the listing. So I'd pull them all off this big long sheet. All right, I get in and I cut them so they were in the actually where they're supposed to be cut. I put them in some semblance of order, and then what I would do, I learned this. One of my columns on my Excel spreadsheet, right, was MLS number. And so what? I would write the latest, the most, the highest MLS number, all right, I'd write that down. Why? Because later on, 4 days from now, if they called me and said, hey, Bob, anything new on the market? I don't know. Let me go check. Couldn't save their search, right? So I went back in. John and Susan Smith, three bedroom, two bedroom, two bath, da-da-da, put all their parameters in. Print them all out. Go through, cut them, and find out, oh, yeah, that one is new. All right, because that has a higher MLS number than the last one I had written down. So you know what I would do is I would I'd take that and drive to their work and say, hey, Karen, here's the new listing that's come on the market since the last list I ran. Boy, that's uphill to school both ways in the snow, right? Okay? Here's the good news about that. I would have eyeball-to-eyeball contact with Karen twice a week. Okay? Right now, oh yeah, it just automated. It just does it for me. How come no one's responding? I've got 48 people on searches. Yeah, and how many people are interacting with you? Zero, right? They're not responding. It's because they're on searches from 48 other realtors too. They're just not telling you, right? So how, here's the beauty. I got eyeball to eyeball with them, and then what happens was this. Now I'm eyeball to eyeball. All of a sudden, I was dropping it off because Karen's working at an office, and she's in a 10 by 10 cubicle, right? And we're just having a quick dialogue. Hey, I know you're busy. I don't want to interrupt you at work. Here's a new listing. What'd you think about the last list I ran? All of a sudden, somebody, over the top of the cubicle. What's going on over there? Because they're in corporate America, and they know that, hey, I've got a 10 by 10, which means I make the same amount of money as Karen. All right? So what are you doing? Oh, Karen's buying a house. Karen's buying a house? 10 by 10, 10 by 10. I rent. She's in. I should be. Well, how's she doing? Oh, we found some bond money, some other stuff. I started selling houses to all the coworkers that right now we don't get to meet because we got it easy and we just send it off electronically. I'm just challenging you. You need to find ways to go old school again. I'm not saying you have to do this so you can't send them automatic updates. I'm saying when their loan gets final approval or they're it passed the home inspection, find a reason to go get a dozen cookies from Publix in one of those little plastic containers, tie a little $1 helium balloon to the thing, and go deliver it to their house, to their work. Find a way to get in front of them and the people they know. All of a sudden, because transactions lead you to transactions. Because guess what? This business is simple. Yeah, you do. All right? We're going to work first-time home buyers. We're going to list by referral only. What does that mean? That means, here's the deal. If you're newer in this business and you don't have a whole lot of success under your belt and you don't dominate the subdivision that you want to dominate in your farm area, all right? Guess what? You go on a listing presentation and you're one of five in. You ain't gonna get it. Right? You're going up against Gary Ubaldini, right? Seriously, right? What's he going to do? He's going to throw down this big old honking report that says, here's a list of all the realtors in Pinellas County. Look where I am. Who else are you interviewing? I'm like, I'm going like, he's on page 22. All right. Oh, yeah, it's listed by volume. Okay. It's like, yeah, if you have to dance for your dinner, remember, like, you should list with me. You should list for me. I'm the best thing you're ever going to see. I'm the, right? That's right, exactly. It's there, all right, okay? All right, if you have to dance for your dinner, you're gonna lose, right? You don't have the chutzpah, you don't got what you got. They've got 8 inches of marketing material and all this kind of stuff that they're gonna do. Can I tell you how I won my listings? It's because I never competed with anybody. You know why? It's because it was the dad of the daughter that I had worked my tail off to get her to buy her first $48,000 condo. And he saw how hard I worked and called me and said, Bob, I just got transferred up to Chicago and I need you to come list my home for $387,000, which in 1995 was like $1 million. All right? And the two cronies in the Prudential Brilliant office who never sold anything but used to bark at me all day long for selling $48,000 homes said, who in the world would trust their $387,000 listing with you? Is that your grandmother? Right? Trust me, I heard it all, right? Who's relative of you? I said, no, it's the dad of the $48,000, one of the 48. Which one? I said, yeah, I know. Trust me, if you sell $48,000 homes, you better sell, it better be which one. All right? You better be selling a lot of them. All right? But that's okay because transactions led me to transactions. And guess what? Is it because I had the best listing presentation that I got the listing? No, I had earned the right to get that listing by showing the dude. He said, Bob goes, I'm a business guy. He said, I saw how hard you worked for 3% of 48,000. I can't imagine how hard you're going to work for 6% of 387. It's good. I say, yeah, that's good logic. I like your logic, especially when it's me involved, right? Okay, because you're right. I am going to bust my tail, all right? If just as hard, if not harder. It's just, that's just, that's the listing presentation you want, right? Hey, here's the market analysis. Here's where I need you to sign. Now, that's a listing presentation. Am I right? Forget this, you know, dancing for your dinner stuff. So that's how we're going to do that. That's corn. Got it?
Okay. I've had people in my database.
Yep.
That I've done transactions with.
Yep.
Helped them buy a home.
Yep. Yep.
And I've consistently kept in contact. I've done eye to eye, stopped by, you know, done all of that.
Yep.
And recently one of them.
Yep.
Talked to me about selling the home that I sold to them.
Correct.
They're moving out.
Yep.
They ended up going with somebody else only because of commission.
Commission price.
Yeah.
The actual.
Yeah.
Can't overcome it. Just a business decision you need to make.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If that's their sole determinant,
yeah.
All right?
That was all right?
It's a decision at a point, I match it or I walk away. All right? And I'll leave that up to you. 100%. I'm with you. There's a certain point you say, hey, you know, it's not worth it to me. I get it. I appreciate it. God bless you. Best of luck. I hope it works for you. If not, love to help you if I can. If I have a buyer, I'll be love to see if I can help bring the buyer to this deal, right? And that's all you can do, you know?
Okay.
That's absolutely, because you can't, you know, and you don't get, but here's the beauty of it, is when either through this or when we get to the next part, you're working with so many people, one doesn't matter, right? That's the beauty of working with a lot of transactions is that when one falls out, I mean, when you're...
Well, it comes down to trusting the process.
Yeah.
You will learn something from that, you'll bring it forward the next time.
Excellent.
And quite frankly, that might be the process they're on, this one's on yours. Really trusting it and taking from it what you can.
Exactly. And say, hey, look, it was good for me to go through that analysis and say, you know what, I ran my numbers, and it's better for me to walk away at only 1.5% than to try and take this thing. Because I don't feel I could properly do my job and do it. But that was a good for you as an internal dialogue to have with yourself to walk through. That's a great point. It's a very good point. Okay, because you learn from it and you do that and move on. It's a great question. All right? So, that being said, go ahead.
When they ask what's your marketing plan?
Mm-hmm. On the listing?
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I didn't have one. Because I didn't have to dance for my dinner. These are people I was just listing their home. I'm going to do everything I can to sell your place.
You know,
all right.
Yes, I get calls.
Right.
But they say, okay.
Yeah.
How are you gonna market it?
Well, I mean, how are you gonna market it? You better have a plan. Don't get me at the wrong. Okay. At the time, I'll put it in the real estate book. Do you remember what that was?
Yeah.
Okay. But I had a plan that was dated for that time. All right. And I did have a plan that I would put it through. But the reality is that you're gonna do everything you can. Get in my opinion, the bottom line is that your job is to market the home, yes, all right? But you make your money by helping them negotiate and do the best pricing. Because quite frankly, put in the MLS, stick a lockbox in, make sure it's enhanced listing with realtor.com, having a virtual tour, all that kind of stuff, they can find that for a flat fee for $295 right now.
Right.
All right? Mm-hmm. So you better say something else. Like, hey, you know what? Getting a contract is important, but getting it from contract to close is as important. And because of that, me understanding the process, knowing how that contract needs to look before we sign it, is vitally important, right? I can see the pitfalls before we even sign, because I've done this. As a matter of fact, it's simple, okay? And so with that in mind, let me help you through that process. Because quite frankly, at the end of the day, there's only so much marketing you can do, right? I mean, and there's only so much marketing that's unique. Is it really unique from what everybody else is going to do? I don't know. What do you got? Maybe you have the killer website that I don't have. All right? Okay, or maybe you're getting more hits than Zillow.
There's not.
But I doubt it. Okay? And as much as we like to, I'm holding out, we're not going to Zillow. God bless you.
And there's no marketing that's a magic pill.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah. It's price right sells.
It's a crapshoot.
Right. Yeah. Price right sells. Right? And so that's, you know, again, and I wish I had a better answer for you other than, you know what, let's put it out there. By the way, 100K group page, you guys on that? Facebook.com/group/the100K club. Join it. It's going to be the main source of us to dialogue with each other. And it's a great resource. We've got 630 some odd agents in there right now. All right. put that kind of question out there. Hey, what are you guys using to market? If you had a listing, what would you use? Where would you market it? What are you guys doing to market your listings? Right? And we got some heavy listing agents that are in there. All right? And they'll answer, and the beauty is that they're just willing to share. All right? Hey, go to the website, check this out. It's just an incredible place. All right? It's a permission only in. All right? You have to have permission to get in, because we get 630 realtors in a Facebook group page. All of a sudden, title people and mortgage people come around. I smell business, right? And so we kind of weed them out, make sure that they're not abusing it. And by the way, rules are, that's not to post your listings, because with 630 people, that's all we would see.
Yeah.
All right? If you have a broker's open, you can post it there. All right? Or if you're willing to allow somebody else to do an open house, you can post it there. All right? But we don't want to hear about your open house. Okay, I'm glad you're having one. We have Future Home Listing Pitch Page or something like that. What's it called?
FHR Listing.
Yeah, there's about 180 agents on that one, and that's where you post your listings if you want to. And they created that. Our agents created that just so that on a listing presentation, hey, look, we got over 1,000 agents, and this is going to go out to our agents. That's a great line, right? But they wanted to be able to say that honestly. So they created this group page that they can put it out there, all right, to have that go. Fair enough. But put that out there. That'd be a great place to go. And I, by the way, everybody join. Got to get in. Okay? Get that done. All right. We got to hurry because we got one more system to talk about. Planting in Orange Grove. All right. Corn's great. Bad news about corn is it's not perennial. It's an annual. Right? Disappears. By the way, that system that I just taught you served me well. Right? I made very good money on the hamster wheel we call real estate. All right? Problem was, I usually took about half a day off in January 1, okay? woke up January 2nd, and hopped right back on, so here we go, all right? Because I was doing 100 transactions a year, mostly from that, by myself and one closing coordinator, all right? Predominantly buyer controlled. It's work, all right? But I was willing to do it because I was making money, all right? Making a lot more money than I was teaching, so I was willing to do it, and I was good, all right? No one ever taught me this. I was a fool. I was arrogant. Imagine that. Me? Arrogant? You think? Right? I got arrogant because I said, you know what? I'll create 100 transactions out of thin air every year. Because I could. I was meeting, on average, one person at every open house I sat, right? Give me 50 weekends a year, Saturday, Sunday. That's 100 weekend days. Boom. Meet one. Convert them, make them a buyer, 100 transactions. Totally ignoring my past clients, totally ignoring the opportunity that was there from the people that I'd served, all right? I got the occasional referral, all right? But it wasn't by design, it was by accident, all right? Totally by accident. Here's what we're gonna teach you, and you guys know it because this is simple.
This
is pretty fun, because now we're going to go into Michael Mayer. It's a better way to live.
Yeah.
All right? Everybody read The 7 Levels of Communication? Okay? Great book. It will be our textbook for this portion of the class. All right? If you haven't read it lately, reread it. It's that good. All right? It's an easy read because it's a story. All right? It's a narrative of a guy looking to get out of the real estate business because it's not easy anymore. Okay? And he said, this isn't working for me, so what do I do? So he goes to one last seminar, swears he's not getting, he should have left his credit card in the car. You know how whenever you go to a seminar, make sure you don't bring your credit card with you. All right? Problem with me, I got my credit cards memorized. All right? I use them so much, I got them memorized. So even if I left it in the car, I could still sneak one by. Right? But he was, I swear this is it. I'm just going as a favor to this lender who talked me into coming to this thing, but I'm not, you know, and next thing you know, people are excited. Next day, you can do this. You know, people are walking, taking off their shoes, walking over hot coals, all right, and do whatever they do. All right, okay, I got it. I can. And so he gets in. Next thing you know, he gets signed up for coaching, right? Coach revolutionizes his life, though. First session with his coach, he wakes up and he gets on the phone call. Guy says, okay, first order of business, cease all advertising. He's like, that's kind of good news. That'll help me recoup what I had to pay you, Mr. Coach, right? If I can cease all advertising, we're not going to advertise. Well, how am I going to, just listen to me. I'm your coach. I'm the mentor. You're the mentee. Shut up and listen, right? Cockamamie, he says, all right? He says, I want to hear your excuses. Cease all advertising. Well, what are we going to do? We're going to systematically approach this business and we're going to attack and get some what we used to call referrals, we're now going to call them introductions. All right? It's a great way to live. It's a much better way to do it because it's just incredible the way things work on this because the results are proven. There are people that are doing it. In essence, they're going to do it. Stop asking for referrals, period. You have not earned the right. How many on the back of your card right now, you don't have to admit it if you don't want to, on the back says, the sincerest form of flattery I could ever receive is a referral from a trusted source, all right? Or here's the other thing we were taught. The other, when we went to that other class, when I found my golf ball, all right? They said, by the way, you're going to go out and reach out to everybody you know. And by the way, at the end of every sentence you ever made, but this is your punctuation. Ready? I don't care if it's a comma or a period. Here is how you end every sentence. By the way, if you or anybody you know looking to buy or sell real estate in 6 months, all right? Pretty soon you stop having conversations because nobody wants to converse with you, yeah. Right? Because you're like, dude, how come, did you come out of the womb saying, by the way, anybody know, looking to buy, first words out of your mouth, mommy, daddy, by the way, you're looking to sell real estate, all right? Quit asking for referrals. Nobody wants to give you one because you want one, right? You're going to get them because you go give massive value first. You go help them benefit in some way. Because here's the thing, people, we want to be in balance, right? And when somebody throws massive value my way, it's like a teeter-totter, a seesaw, right? Okay, now I've got this massive value that Karen, you know, did me a favor. And whether I admit it verbally or not, psychologically, like, I owe Karen. Man, I got to get back in balance. Hey, man, you know what? Karen, here you go. I owe her one, right? People remember that. You don't need to tell them every time you're a realtor. They know, all right? They know, all right? We're talking about people that know, right? So you're going to go out and you're going to start talking to these people again. You're going to re-engage with these people, and they know. And sometimes you might not get the business because someone's going to undercut you on commission. Big deal, right? Forget it and move on. Here we go, all right? Let's stop asking for referrals. We're going to focus on people and relationships. Stop chasing business and start attracting it. We're going to go deeper with a few rather than shallow with many, right? All you need, if you remember Michael, all right? It's all around. 150 is all you need in your database. If you remember it, he pares that database down. Remember, he grades it, all right? Teaches him to grade. They pair that thing down to 150. We teach two numbers here, 150 and 22,500. What's that? 150 squared, right? Because 150, no 150, right? If you've got 150, you've really got 22,500 if you take care of the 150. Are you with me? Okay. And 22,500 is all the business you'll ever need. Okay. All right. Even Chris, as good as he is, couldn't handle all that business. All right. 22,500. It's just a magical number. It's amazing how this. We're going to stop selling, start attracting. All right. We're going to read that book. That's one of the things. Now, here, I told you didn't have to pay me $850 to get in the door, right? So here's all you owe me, though, is that we are going to be committed. At the end of each session, you're going to see here what our basic breakdown is going to be. We're going to go old school, and we're going to write down what you're... I wanted to call this last time. This is the first time we did it. We called it the committed, right? And it was a time that we were just going to do raw accountability, all right? Say, hi, my name is Karen. In the next 2 weeks, I'm going to... by saying it out there, and by the way, if you come to this class, it's being recorded, all right? So you don't argue with me, all right? I'll have to write it down because it'll be recorded. We can go back to the tape. Let's go back to the tape. All right, and find out what happened. All right, I toyed with this last time. I wanted to call this Excuse Makers Anonymous. All right, and make it like a 12-step program. All right, hi, my name's Karen. Hi, Karen. All right. But I thought that sounded too negative. All right, so I decided we'll do the committed. All right, these are the people that are really going to commit to doing something because this time we're going to do it. We're going to finish. We're not going to just talk about it. We're going to actually make it happen. And it's going to be different for everybody. And we're just going to go around the room. All right, and we're going to spend some time going around the room and saying, okay, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? We're going to track it. We're going to make small tweaks along the way. We're not going to let you quit on yourself. We're going to make this happen. That's what the committed is all about. All right, we're going to be. This is simple. All right, we're going to agree to submit to an accountability partner and to the group. All right, you're going to have a one-on-one accountability partner as well as the group as you're going to be accountability partner as well. You're going to meet with your accountability partner because we're going to meet every other week in essence. There's a couple weeks, a couple times will be 3 weeks in between just based upon schedules. But you're going to meet with your accountability partner one-on-one in between sessions. All right, so you can kind of be there for each other. All right. Don't allow anything to stop you from taking the steps in the process. And by the way, get a good accountability partner. If you've got an accountability partner, oh yeah, we've been together 15 years and that's always been my accountability partner. Well, obviously it ain't working for you. Get a new accountability partner. You're too easy on yourselves. All right? You listen to their excuses, they listen to yours, and it's just a great codependent relationship. All right? Okay. Stop being that. Find somebody who's going to bust your backside. All right? Say, hey, you know what? No. Right? I don't want to hear it. You said, yeah, but my kid got sick. I get it. Life happens. All right? So what? All right? Tell that to the mortgage guy. Right? You got a mortgage to pay next month? Tell him your kid got sick. They don't care. All right? They don't. All right, that sounds harsh. It is harsh. Okay, welcome to the real world. Okay, all right, we're going to stop making excuses. We're not going to succumb to lack of effort, and we're going to finish. All right, so here are your commitments to the team. You ready? This is where I step on toes a little bit, so nobody's in the front row. That's good. Okay, willing to change. All right, honest and accountable. This is what you're paying me, right? You don't pay me money. This is what you're going to pay me. Agree to read one book a month. First one's going to be this Michael Mayer book, so it'll be nice and easy. All right, get 8 hours of sleep a night. Okay, I know. Make it a goal, and you can. It is, isn't it? Okay? There's freedom and structure. I'm telling you, that's, you know, you. Once you start to live this way, you're healthier, good things start to happen. Because guess what? You're going to pay the piper. You're going to get caught up. Oh, I can't get 8 hours sleep a night. Next thing I know, you're sick in bed, sleeping 16 hours a day, catching up with all the hours that you missed because you got sick because you weren't sleeping 8 hours a night.
You need your dreams.
Yes, you. Thank you. Very. I like that.
You need your dreams.
I love that.
Sleep.
That is pretty cool. I haven't thought about that. Okay. You need your dreams. You need your dreams. Okay. Now I can say it. You know what I've always said? You need your dreams. All right. Because the third time I say it, it's mine. All right. I own it. So you need your dreams. Good job. All right. Good job, Pat. Drink 64 ounces of water a day. I dare you.
I already do.
What's that?
Or more.
Or more. Absolutely. You already do? Good. Good for you. You should. All right. You know why I have to put this one on there? Because I need to commit to you.
That's two of these.
See? That's it.
That's it.
Two of those. Piece of cake. Coffee doesn't count. All right. There's water in coffee. Right? Doesn't count. Talking pure water.
Beer and wine.
Beer, nope. Doesn't count either. All right. Okay. All right. Pure water. All right. And the reason I have to say this, because my tongue is naturally attracted to Dr. Pepper. All right. Okay. I know. Exactly. No. Pure water. Yeah. How am I going to tell? As long as it's clear. Exactly. All right. Agree to perform 30 minutes cardiovascular exercise 3 days a week. Mm-hmm. What does this have to do? What does that have to do with selling real estate? The answer is nothing but everything.
Yeah.
It does. Keeps you healthy. You know what also keeps you healthy? Right here. Because guess what? This morning, I didn't get my 8 hours of sleep after last night, but I got up at 5 a.m., make sure I hit the gym at the thing, got my push-ups and sit-ups in, and did my 45 minutes of cardio. You know what happened when I walked out the door pulling my little carry-on bag? All right? Look out. People just say, I was parting. It's like people just getting out of my way. All right? Why?
Because you
didn't
shower.
Well, there you go. That's an awesome one right there. That was good. How'd you know? Why is nobody in the front row? I don't get it. That's right. I thought it's because they were just respecting me, but they were just respecting me. I get it. Love it. That's awesome. Very good. I'm just telling you, there's something powerful about when you put your pants on and they fit. I'm just telling you, it's a psychological thing that works. I'm like, dadgum, right on, all right? Bring it today, all right? I'm just telling you, it's what it is. Good things happen when you start to feel good about how you look, how you feel, the way you were. Plus, guess what? Darn right you should do business with me. I was disciplined today. I got up and did my stuff, and I started my day off right. I said I was going to do it. It was in my calendar. I have freedom and structure, and I knocked it off. By the way, write things down. Mm-hmm. You know what's to say? It's cathartic about making that big, fat, heavy check mark next to something. It's like, you damn straight I did that, right? Is what you're saying. Okay, exactly. Big, fat, hairy, big old black marker cross that thing out, right? Yeah, because it helps, right? I am doing something today that doesn't involve going to eat another bagel, right? All right, we're going to make that happen. So that's why we do that. We volunteer at a nonprofit 4 hours a month, somewhere, someplace. I don't care. Find one. All right? What is it? What? How am I ever? Yeah, whatever. All right, you got time. Figure it out. Here's what happens. I have never had anybody do this consistently. And when I say over a period of 3 to 4 months, and come back to me and say, here's what always happens. People always get business out of it. Okay. Always. It's not why we do it. It is not why we do it. All right? Because if that's why you do it, then it doesn't work. You'll be the one. All right? It comes back to me and says it didn't work. Because that's always your method behind doing it, right? But there's something about if you're into homeless pets and once a month you're elbow deep in suds washing mangy dogs that have been rescued and you're with three other people in this pit of whatever they've got going on there, right? There's a bond. Automatically, there's an assumption that you and I are alike somehow, right? Because not everybody donates 4 hours a month to wash mangy dogs. And so you start striking up conversations, and you're this, and she's a clerk, and that's that, and what do you do? And I'm a real estate agent, and my aunt's moving, and next thing you know. It just happens, all right? And it's plus you walk out feeling, you know what, that was better than four back-to-back-to-back-to-back House of Cards or whatever you watch, okay? Whatever, what do you guys been to watch? What's that? Game of Thrones? Okay, all right, something like that. All right, good deal, all right? Okay, all right, okay? So volunteer at a nonprofit 4 hours a month. Donate 10%. Here's where I start stepping on toes. Donate 10% of your income to a church, a synagogue, or other nonprofit. Okay? I call it a tithe because that's what my Bible calls it, but I dare you to do this. Yeah, but Bob, you can't. I'm not making you do anything. I'm just telling you that you're going to live better when you do. Okay? Like the law of the harvest and the law of gravity, that's a law, in my opinion. All right? And it works. Yeah, but I can't get by in 100. You can't get by in 100% of 40,000, but you can get by on 90% of 200. All right? And it works. Go do it. I challenge you. Worship once a week with other people that think like you. Oh, Bob, but I'm de-churched. I get it. There are a lot of reasons to be churched, and not 100% of them have to do with people.
Yeah,
all right?
I'm back to the beer and wine thing.
Okay, right. Understand? Okay. There you go. There you go. Like-minded people. There you go. All right? But I just, you know, go hang out with people that think like you do. All right? And I get it, man. You know what? If you haven't been to church in a while, go consider it. If nothing else, go to the beach, stand on a dune, look at the water, and realize there's a higher power that ain't you. Okay? Start there. All right? But I like hanging out with other people that think like me. All right? Which is hard to find sometimes. All right, but that's all right. All of this is going to require discipline and accountability, but I guarantee you this. It's not going to be easy. It is simple. Yeah, you do. All right? But it will be a defining moment in your life, spiritually, emotionally, intellectually, physically, and financially. All those, right? And in that order, all right? Financial kind of is the least of those, all right? That's a financial benefits are the byproduct of all the other stuff. I'm just telling you, it works that way, all right? Finish this time, all right? This is simple. There you do. All right, basic meeting agenda. We're going to come in. We're going to spend 20 minutes trying to clean up how we do our lead generation, traffic generating events. What are you doing? Sherry, what do you do at the flea markets?
Yeah, I have a bank foreclosure open house that we do every Saturday and Sunday. If you guys need any buyers now, you need people to work with or whatever, just give me your cards. We're going to have some training and stuff. We need a ton of people.
And where do you do them? You said bank foreclosure open house. Where?
At the flea market. So we have Wagon Wheel and Oldsmar. So depending on which location you specify in, just let me know. We're going to have some training in the next couple weeks because starting in February, March, we're jammed. We normally get between 40 and 60 new clients a weekend. We need two agents at all times.
People hanging out at the flea market. So you got a booth at the flea market that says bank foreclosure open house information.
Stop in.
Really?
500 to 1,000.
You ever sold a house to somebody from there?
Oh, all of them. I mean, that's how I've generated all my business the last 2 years. So, the last 50 closes.
People go to the flea market to buy taser guns, right?
They go to the flea market because they're looking for something to do.
There you go. All right? And guess what? They're at the flea market looking for something to do, and you're looking to get eyeball to eyeball with people.
Yeah.
It's a traffic generating event. talk to Sherry. She can get you all the details of what she does. We'll walk through, hey, I want to set regular bank-owned open house. How do I do that? Who do we have? How do I know? How do I get somebody to allow me to do that? Piece of cake. Been there, done it. All right, wrote the book. Should write the book. All right, but I didn't write the book, but could write the book. I'll teach you how to do it. 20 minutes of laser focus on how to get highly effective traffic-generating events, corn planting. Spend about 40 minutes on orange grove planting, because at the end of the day, I really would rather you do orange grove at the end of the day, because that becomes our walkaway. That becomes our residual. That becomes a business out of the real estate business, not just a hamster wheel, right? Then we're going to shift into the committed, spend 45 minutes of raw accountability. Okay, based upon what we just covered, what are you going to do between now and the next time we see you, right? And I want commitments to it, and you're not going to do it. And what's going to happen is half of you are going to show up, because you don't want to be committed. I get it, all right? Keep on doing what you're doing. Keep on getting what you're getting. All right? I've been a lot of motivational stuff. I could keep quoting that stuff like it was, you know, just it's in there. But some of that other stuff, is that plaque is still there. All the times I've been to those, that plaque, I'm telling you, the negative way, you know? Like, hey, that thing's nasty. I can't get rid of that thing. This is simple.
Got it.
All right, good deal. Are you ready? Here are your assignments for next meeting. Obtain a copy of The 7 Levels of Communication by Michael Maron. Read it. Okay, if you got a hard copy, great. If not, you can get one on Amazon, I think. The online version is like $3.99 or something like that. Okay, download the audio, whatever you want to do. Okay, I suggest you get a hard copy of it because I want you to highlight the thing. All right, it's there.
The audio's not that great.
Is it not?
It's done by Michael, and he's not the best.
Okay. Now, here's the other thing.
So writing the story is fine.
Right, it just doesn't flow.
No.
All right, yeah. All right, good deal. By the way, Michael is part of the 100K group page, so be careful of your criticism of the book. All right, okay, because he follows the 100K group page. Every once in a while, you'll see him chime in, all right, when you mention his name. So that's okay. That's right, okay. All right, come along with an accountability partner in mind and one that's not going to be codependent, right? Everybody agree with that? Bring someone else with you next time because half of you aren't going to show up, so we'll have plenty of room for the other half that do show up and bring somebody, all right? All right, join the Facebook group page. You have to get permission to get in. So give me a minute or two because I'm actually heading over to another Lunch and Learn in Valrico right now. So just give me some time and I'll get you all approved to get in there and start asking questions, figure out stuff. Hey, anybody, you know what? Why wait around? Do a bank-owned open house before we get together in 2 weeks. Why not? All right? Why wait? It's early. Get going. Find a way to be around other like-minded people. Come hang out with our coffee chats, our Lunch and Learns, everything else we've got. All right, I don't want to hear next year, I think I'm going to leave because I didn't feel like I had support from Future Home Realty. Well, I never saw you, right? Yeah. And if you come and if you're looking for it to be coddled, you're right. Yeah, you maybe you need to go someplace else, all right? Okay, decide you're going to finish this time, all right? This is simple.
I got it.
Yeah, you do. One last thing. Some of you here at a crossroads, some of you are like, hey, I don't know if this is going to do it, all right? I just paid my board dues again. One last time, I swore I wasn't going to do it this time, all right, but I did it anyway, so here I am, all right, should I continue? If no one else in your life, even you sometimes, have got to this point, all right, has ever believed in you, I believe in you, because this is simple. Yeah, you do. I believe that you got this, all right, I really do, all right, cool? Next session is 2 weeks from today, right here, so that's what, the 18th, thank you, all right, the 18th. And we'll see you there. Join the Facebook group page. You got any questions in the meantime, reach out. And we'll see you.
Okay.
All right. Oh, the other thing, too. If you want a copy of the PowerPoint, email me. Or if you hang out a little bit, give me some time because I still teach this in Jacksonville next week. After the Jacksonville session, I'll post it on the 100K group page, the slides. 9:30 we'll be here. Yeah.